بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله رب العالمين، والصلاة والسلام على أشرف الأنبياء والمرسلين نبينا محمد وعلى آله وأصحابه أجمعين. We praise Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We thank him upon all conditions. We ask him to send blessings and salutations upon Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, his entire household, all his companions. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless them all, and may he bless every single one of us. Ameen. My beloved brothers and sisters, the gifts of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala upon us are many. Some of them are quite clear for us to see, and others we would need to dig a little bit before we realize that this is a gift of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Some of these gifts that are hidden, in fact not so hidden, but they would require an effort from us to discover them or to realize what exactly they are. Some of these, the reason why they are not so clear is because as we grew up, we did not really pick up the difference between us and the others of a similar age group. And there are two such gifts that are made mention of in the hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam that I wish to talk about this afternoon. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam says, نِعْمَتَانِ مَغْبُونٌ فِيهِمَا كَثِيرٌ مِّنَ النَّاسِ. There are two gifts, and the ni'am of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, referring to the gifts or the boons of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, in one verse in the Quran or in a few places in the Quran, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَإِن تَعُدُّوا نِعْمَةَ اللَّهِ لَا تُحْصُوهَا. If you are ever going to try to count the gifts of Allah upon you, you will not be able to do that. You will never be able to circumscribe them or to count them all. You might start writing a list. You'll have a few thousand things, and it will still continue up to the day you die. You will not be able to actually get all of them jotted down. So this shows that there are gifts of Allah that we need to search for, understand their value, and appreciate them. So the two gifts that are spoken about in the hadith, the Prophet ﷺ says, these two gifts, many people are deceived regarding them. Al-ghabn. Ghabn is when a person doesn't really know the reality. They are deceived in some regard. You know, for example, if you are buying, just an example, if you're buying a watermelon, mashallah, and you don't know whether the taste of it inside is actually going to be as the person who is selling it to you is telling you. So by right, you have an option of asking him to slice it on condition that you pay his price. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us an understanding. So going back to this, two things many people are deceived about. The first one is health. Your health is such a gift of Allah. Like I said, when we are young and we grow up, those in our age group, the bulk of them, they would probably, we would not pick up if anyone was really seriously sick. And even if they were, we always feel sometimes when we are normal and healthy that, you know what, it won't happen to me. We feel that. And one day suddenly when it overtakes you, you realize, guess what, it was too late and it now is too late. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgive us, and may He grant us an understanding of the value of this beautiful gift of Allah, the health. If I spend a few moments speaking about health, we will realize the entire body is so sophisticatedly connected that if something goes wrong with a single part of your body, the rest of the body is restless. And the rest of the body is affected. Take for example, the breathing that we have. Do you know, if you sit for a moment and think, and this is why Allah says, وَفِي أَنفُسِكُمْ أَفَلَا تُبْصِرُونَ. Do you not look within yourselves to discover the signs and the greatness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? Look within yourself. If you have to sit and think about the breathing, you and I are breathing right now. Do you know what happens? It starts off with your nose and mouth, and it goes through the entire respiratory system, the lungs. If there is anything wrong with any part of the body connected to your breathing, you would feel lethargic, you would probably feel sickly, you might feel lazy, and various other problems. You know, they say the oxygen levels that are actually taken in would vary from person to person, and depending on how good your oxygen intake is, that is how healthy you feel, because the body needs the oxygen. But did we ever think of this? When we were born, we were too young to understand, and as we became of understanding age, well, we had other, according to us, bigger things to think about, so we never ever thought about these things. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is asking us to ponder over this gift and to make sure we do not waste it, and we do not lose the value of this beautiful gift. We appreciate it. So I look at how I breathe. I look at the faculty of sight, seeing. Ask those who cannot see. The hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam says, whomsoever Allah has taken away his eyesight or her eyesight in this life, he grants them in return for their patience Jannah without reckoning. Subhanallah. If Allah has taken your eyesight away and you've borne the sabr or the patience required, He gives you Jannah in return, because it is such a big gift of Allah, one of the senses. So this is why I ask those who have a problem with their eyesight and you realize the value of yours. Ask those who have a problem with their hearing and you will realize the value of yours. But if you do not ask, you do not look, you do not take time to consider the value of your gift, then may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgive us. Perhaps you spend an entire lifetime without having thanked Allah for such a blessed gift. This is why it is a great sunnah of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam to visit the sick. One of the reasons is exactly what we are talking about today, that you visit the sickly, those who are struggling in one way or another. You make dua for them, and when you are with them, you appreciate what you have. Allahu Akbar. You appreciate, you thank Allah. Ya Allah, at least I can fulfill my salah, for example, standing. Ask those who cannot. At least I am a person who, for example, can walk without any assistance. At least I am a person who can hear without any hearing aids. Or I am a person perhaps who can, reach out to get whatever I want without the assistance of others. Ask those who are paralyzed, those who have lost limbs. But it would require from us the deep thinking thought and the pondering over the gifts of Allah in order to be able to appreciate such a blessed gift known as health. It's one simple word, but believe me, it is your entire life. Health is actually a treasure that is granted to us from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So how do I show my appreciation for the health that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has blessed me with? Point number one, I need to ensure that I use the limbs and the health that Allah has given me to obey Allah's instructions. He has asked me to obey, to fulfill salah, to abstain from prohibition, and for example, to speak correctly. You know, there are certain people who cannot talk. They are, may Allah protect us all, but they, I wouldn't like to use the word dumb, but for all practical purposes, they cannot speak. And certain people, for example, who can, or all of us, the bulk of us who can speak, is it not true that sometimes we use the same tongue, the same voice, and the same gift of Allah to disobey Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? May He forgive us. Really, what a blessed gift, the mouth and the capacity to speak. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us all an understanding. So the first point of showing appreciation to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is to be able to use these faculties to obey Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Secondly, to thank Him verbally, to say, oh Allah, I thank you for the eyesight you've given me, for the breathing, for the nose, the senses that you've blessed me with, the health that you've granted me. Ya Allah, I thank you for this and I appreciate it. Sometimes what happens, people turn far away from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and then as a blessing and a mercy, He takes part of their health away so that they turn back to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And this is why with all of us, every single one of us has been through what is known as the common cold, and we are affected by it on a regular basis, perhaps once a year or a few years. A common cold, a cough, sometimes a little allergy we have, these are signs of Allah. And the fact that He is in control, if He wanted, we would not have needed to go through these phases or these seasonal sicknesses that come through. We would not have needed, or He would not have needed to make us go through that. But it's for us to realize
the gift of Allah upon us. You have a little allergy, a small tablet might help you by the help of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But without that, what would happen? We would probably get up in the morning all clogged up, and you know, the eyes would be red and so much would happen and we wouldn't even know. So may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless us, and may He make us from those who can use this health in the right direction. So to thank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with our tongues, to appreciate what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has blessed us by thanking Him, "Oh Allah, I thank You for what You've given me." And to be from amongst those whom, whenever any part of our health is affected, immediately we become closer to Allah. Never ever become angry and agitated and irritated because you are suffering a health problem. No. Take it in your stride. Understand. Call out to Allah. Ask Him for help. And go and seek medication. It would be wrong for us to say, "I lay my trust in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and I do not need to visit the doctor." That is wrong. Because part and parcel of laying your trust in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is to go out to seek cure for what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has inflicted you with within your capacity. So I have the capacity to visit the doctor, I must go. Because this health is actually a test from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It is Allah's choice to test us through the body that we have. Isn't it that this body is going to be buried in the grave when we die? And isn't it that the body will return into the soil, as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, "Minha khalaqnakum wa fiha nu'idukum wa minha nukhrijukum taratan ukhra." We have created you from the same soil. We will return you into the soil and we will resurrect you from it once again. That shows that we will be returned to the soil. So the body I have and you have today is actually not ours. It belongs to Allah. He has entrusted us with it for a short period of time. When something goes wrong with it, your duty to seek medication, your duty to give it a rest. And this is why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has created the night in order to rest, and He has created the daytime in order to work. Obviously, if you're on night shift sometime, you might have, you know, have it the other way around. But we're talking here of the general rule. So if you do not rest, you are actually doing a great disservice to yourself and your body. You are transgressing, because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has instructed you to rest. Your body, the hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam says, وَلِنَفْسِكَ عَلَيْكَ حَقَّ لِبَدَنِكَ عَلَيْكَ حَقَّ. You have a right that needs to be fulfilled of your bodies and of yourself. You have a right to fulfill. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala help us to fulfill this beautiful right. In a way, if we take a look at sickness, like I said a few moments ago, it is a blessing of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, an opportunity to get close to Allah. Every one of us, myself included, when we are ill, and sometimes we, or maybe sick in a different way, there would come a stage when we would understand, "Look, I need to call out to Allah." Different people understand at a different stage. Some people immediately, they would call out to Allah. And some people, it takes time. They will first say, "You know what, let's go and have this medication, let's try this painkiller, let's try that." And then they say, "Ya Allah, we've tried everything, help us." A mu'min, a believer, is he or she whom, from the time before the health is negatively affected, they are already asking Allah, "Oh Allah, protect our health." That is a believer. And this is the hadith of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He used to make dua for health and for so many other factors, even before he was ever sick, before he was affected by anything. He says, "Oh Allah, grant me the goodness or the good use of the faculties that You've given me. My hearing, my sight, and all the energies You've granted me. Oh Allah, help me to use it in a good way. Do not take it away from us in a way that we would be left sick and ill." May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala help us to understand these great du'as, and may He make us from those who would call out to Allah whilst we are healthy. And this is why another narration of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he makes it quite clear where he says there are five things. If you do not seize those opportunities, five opportunities, if you don't seize them, they will be definitely overtaken by five conditions which would then result in regret. One of them is your health. Whilst you are healthy, do what you have to. Whilst you are healthy, thank Allah. Ask Allah to protect you. There will come a day when you will not perhaps be able to worship Allah the way you would have been able to when you were healthy, or the way you are able to today. And this is why moments ago I said, ask those who cannot read salah standing anymore and make the sujood in the proper way. Perhaps they would regret the days that they did not increase their voluntary prayer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Because it's not the same. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala help us all. May He grant cure to all those who are sick and ill. And it brings me to one of the main points when it comes to the sicknesses of others. Always learn to pray for other people. Never become delighted and happy that this person is sick, that one is sick. Oh, mashallah, you know, they deserved it. That is not a mu'min. A true believer knows that whatever they are afflicted with, it can come to me today. It can come to me tomorrow. Anything can happen and I can be affected by it. And even if I am not, the fact that I call out for my fellow Muslim, the fact that I call out for a person who is suffering and struggling in their health, do you know the angels are calling out with the same dua for me? So why don't we achieve that? Why don't we seize the opportunity? You see someone, you make a dua for them. La ba'sa tahurun insha'Allah. The sunnah of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, asking for their cure and asking for a reward to be given to them for the sabr that they are going through. And you say, oh Allah, don't test me with the same. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless us. So the first point that the hadith that we are speaking about today makes mention of is the issue of health. I hope I've said enough regarding health that would convince us or at least move us to the degree that we appreciate the health we have. You know, to fulfill your salah on time, to be able to read the Quran whilst you can actually read correctly, to be able to obey Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's instruction, all this we need to ponder over and we need to ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The second issue that is mentioned in the same hadith we started with, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam says, al-faragh. Al-faragh meaning free time. Your free time and my free time. When we are young, what do we do with the free time? Let's be honest. We play games and sometimes we use it in something that is futile because you are very young, a little toddler, an infant. There is nothing more you could do. And as you grow up, you then go to school, your free time becomes less. You know, your first days at a nursery school, for example, what we would call a preschool, your first days at preschool would occupy you so much that when you come back, you are tired, you need to sleep. A little child. And then what happens? Your free time is reduced. As you grow up a little bit more, free time reduced. When you graduate from primary school to high school, your free time is reduced even more. And when you go up further, your free time is actually almost diminishing. You just have a weekend, and that too sometimes, how you spend it, Allah knows. So the hadith of the Prophet ﷺ, he tells us, free time is a ni'mah. It's actually a gift from Allah to test you. What do you do in it? And where do we get this from? The beginning of the hadith, where the Prophet ﷺ says, ni'matani. These are two gifts of Allah. And Allah says, ثُمَّ لَتُسْأَلُنَّ يَوْمَ إِذٍ عَنِ النَّعِيمِ. On the day of judgment, you will be asked about the gifts of Allah. One of them is your free time. What did you do in your time that was free? Did you use it to gain closeness to Allah? Did you use it to solve crises and problems? Did you use it with your family constructively? Did you use it with the ummah constructively? Or did you sin? Did you waste it? You see, there are several categories of this free time and the way it is used. The best of which is in the obedience of Allah or constructively. The second is a person who does nothing, waste. I was just sleeping. I was free and I was sleeping. If that is the case, we have failed the test as well. Because life is like an hourglass where the sand keeps going. Whether you are sleeping or awake, the same sand is going. You are still losing your time. So you'd rather make sure that you do not unnecessarily waste that time in a way, or should I say, you do not waste the time in a way that you could have done something constructive, and one day when you become occupied, you realize and it would be too late by then. So this is why the worst person is he who spends his free time sinning and transgressing against Allah. And this people, the young of today, sometimes we sit and we think, oh, I've got 2 hours to kill. Come, let's go and watch a movie. What are you doing? You could have spent that time so constructively, and here you are, a movie. The hadith says, if a person says Subhanallah wa bihamdihi 100 times a day, his sins are washed away, even if they were like the froth of the ocean. Subhanallah. How many times and how many of us, myself included, have said Subhanallah wa bihamdihi, you know, glorifying Allah and praising Allah, more than 100 times a day or 100 times a day? May Allah forgive us, really. It's a powerful narration, but we should repeat these words. Today is a Friday. I call on you to praise Allah and glorify Him using your tongue, your free time. The first thing that must come to your mind, let me go and learn the Quran a bit more. It's the only word of Allah that we have available here. Allahu Akbar. My Maker and yours has given me a word. It's the only word of Allah. I spend some time in the day. Don't get tired and sick of it, because there will come a day when you will not have that free time. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala help us understand these two great gifts of His. As-sihhatu wal-faragh. The health that He has blessed us with, and the free time we have. And may we spend our free time constructively, and may we use all the faculties He has blessed us with in the best possible way, so that the day it is taken away, we do not regret. And the day we return to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, we have no regret. May Allah forgive us all. Wa sallallahu wa sallama ala nabina Muhammad.